Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjali Ammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Koyilvanni. I am happy to meet you again in the video lecture on the subject Fluid Mechanics and Machines. We are continuing with the previous lecture on reciprocating pump. This is second lecture on the reciprocating pump. In the earlier lecture, we defined the reciprocating pump. And we have discussed the working of the reciprocating pump, single acting and the double acting reciprocating pump. And we calculated the work done for the reciprocating pump. We defined the coefficient of discharge slip of the reciprocating pump. And we described the indicator diagram and calculating the work done or the power with the help of the indicator diagram. And here in this lecture, we are going to discuss about the reciprocating pump with the air vessels. So, the significance or importance of the air vessel, and we discuss the positive displacement rotary pumps like gear pump, van pump and the lobe pump. The learning outcome to the students, at the end of the lecture, the student will be able to explain the usefulness of the air vessels in the reciprocating pump, compare the centrifugal and the reciprocating pumps, discuss about the gear pump, van pump and the lobe pump. Air vessel. So, in the previous lecture, we discussed the reciprocating pump without the air vessel and we said the delivery of a single acting reciprocating pump is intermittent. For every revolution of the crankshaft, there will be only one delivery during the operation of the pump. For every revolution, there will be one delivery of water in the case of single acting reciprocating pump. And if you want continuous delivery of water, we are using the double acting reciprocating pump. But in the single acting reciprocating pump, we want the continuous supply of water in the delivery pipe. So, for that, we install the air vessels on the delivery side and the suction side. So, when you install the air vessel, the water will be delivered continuously. An air vessel is a closed chamber containing compressed air in the upper part and liquid being pumped in the lower part. So, if you look at the air vessel, so you have partially filled liquid and you have the compressed air. And here again, we have partially filled liquid and the air, compressed air. So, the air is compressed because of the air, water in the liquid in the air vessel. One air vessel is fixed on the suction pipe just near the suction valve. So, here we have the suction valve, just below the suction valve we have the air vessel, and another air vessel is fixed in the delivery pipe near the delivery valve. So, at the outlet, just at the outlet of the delivery valve we have a air vessel. Now, what is the air vessel? The purpose of the air vessel. When the piston is reciprocating backward, the suction valve opens and the liquid will be drawn into the cylinder. Due to the pressure difference. So, vacuum will be created as the piston is moving towards the right side and the suction valve open and the liquid will be drawn into the cylinder. And during this operation, the air water in the air vessel, it is also added here. And during the delivery stroke, when the piston is reciprocating from the right side to the left side, the water is compressed and the delivery valve is opened and the water will be delivered here. And the excess water will be stored in the air vessel in the delivery side. And during the next suction stroke, the vacuum is created here. So, the water will be drawn into the cylinder. At the same time, the water or the liquid in the air vessel on the delivery side will be discharged to the tank, delivery side. So, if you may find continuous supply of liquid in the delivery pipeline. That is the advantage of air vessel in the single acting reciprocating pump. The other designation, HS is the suction head, HD is the delivery head. So, this is HD, delivery head, this is the suction head, and you have the LD is the length of the delivery pipe, and the L-D is the length between the air vessel and the cylinder, top of the cylinder, and similarly L-S equal to the length between the air vessel and the cylinder, and the center of the air vessel is measured as suction head. So, this is the suction pipeline. then the air vessel are used for the following purpose: to get the continuous supply of liquid at a uniform rate, to minimize the power required to drive the pump, to run the pump at a much higher speed without any danger of separation, water separation. So water separation is a major type of loss in the pump, any pump. So the separation will not happen when you have a air vessel in the suction and the delivery side. So the indicator diagram with and without air vessel. So this is the indicator diagram without the air vessel, and this is the effect of the horizontal, the inclined line. This is the dotted line and inclined line, inclined dotted line and a curved line, and this is because of the acceleration and the friction losses in the reciprocating pump. So this is the actual indicator diagram without the air vessel, and this is the indicator diagram with the air vessel. So the inclined line, because of the continuous supply of water, you will get a horizontal line at the top and the bottom of the indicator diagram. And now it is easy to calculate the area of the indicator diagram. It is just a rectangle, and this is the indicator diagram without the air vessel, and this rectangle is the indicator diagram with the air vessel. And now the work done or power expended against the friction with the air vessel in a single acting pump. So P1 equal W A L N by 60 into 4 F L by 3 G D capital A by small a into omega R whole square, where F is the friction factor, L is the length of the suction and delivery pipe of the pump, D is the diameter of suction and delivery pipe, R is the radius of the crank, omega is the angular velocity, and small a is the cross-sectional area of the suction and the delivery pipe. Work done or power expended against the friction with the air vessel in a single acting pump. So this is equal to W A L N by 60 into 4 F L by 2 G D into capital A by small a into omega R by pi whole square. Now the percentage of work saved in the pipe friction by fitting air vessel in the single acting pump. So P1 minus P2 divided by P1, substituting. So this equal to 1 minus P2 by P1, substituting for P2 and P1 and simplifying, you will get 1 minus 3 by 2 pi R square, which is 0.848 or 84.8%. So we can save up to work 84.8% when you install the air vessel in a single acting pump. So work done or power expended against friction with the air vessel in a double acting pump. So P1 equal to W into ALN by 60 into 4 F L by 3 G D 2 A by 2 capital A divided by small a omega into omega R square, omega R to the whole square. And when the work done or power expended against friction with the air vessel in a double acting pump. So this is P2 equal to W A L N by 60 into 4 F L by 2 G D 2 capital A by small a into omega R by pi whole square. Now the percentage of work saved in pipe friction by fitting air vessel in the double acting pump. So once again, P1 minus P2 divided by P1, which is 1 minus P2 by P1. This is 1 minus, substituting for P2 and P1, will get 1 minus 3 by 2, 2 by pi whole square, which is 1 minus 6 by pi square, which is 0.392 or 39.2%. So in a double acting pump, we can save 39.2% of power when you install the air vessel in the double acting reciprocating pump. And we compare the centrifugal pump and reciprocating pump. So in the chapter 12, we discuss about the centrifugal pump, and in this lecture, we discuss about the reciprocating pump, and we compare these two devices. Nowadays, when you want a high pressure, by reading the table, we can understand. In a centrifugal pump, it is simple in construction, whereas a reciprocating pump, it is complicated in construction. Centrifugal pump, it has got a rotor and the suction pipe, delivery pipe, suction valve, delivery valve. But here we have the reciprocating mechanism, valve mechanism for admitting and delivery of water. So the design or construction is complicated in the case of reciprocating pump. Total weight of the pump is less for given discharge. So in the case of reciprocating pump, the total weight of the pump is more for the same discharge because of various components involved in the reciprocating pump. Centrifugal pump, they are suitable for large discharge at lower head, lower pressure. So lower head or lower pressure. So large discharge at lower pressure, whereas reciprocating pump, they are suitable for small discharge at a higher head, higher pressure. So centrifugal pump require lesser floor area and simple foundation, whereas the reciprocating pump require a more floor area and comparatively heavy foundation because of the reciprocating action of the piston inside the cylinder. So in the centrifugal pump, there will be less wear and tear. So because there is no reciprocating component, it's only rotary machine, so the wear and tear will be less. In the case of reciprocating pump, more wear and tear due to reciprocating action. And the centrifugal pump operating and maintenance cost is less. In the case of reciprocating pump, operating and maintenance cost is more because it is to be lubricated and it should be maintained well for proper or efficient operation. Centrifugal pump can handle dirty water. So whereas reciprocating pump, it cannot handle the dirty water. So centrifugal pump, sometimes they are used for handling the slurry municipal waste, whereas the reciprocating pump, it will handle only pure liquid. Centrifugal pump, the delivery is continuous, and the reciprocating pump, the delivery is pulsating. Centrifugal pump can run at a higher speed, so the reciprocating pump, they can run at a slower speed. Centrifugal pump, no air vessel is required. So in the case of reciprocating pump, we require the air vessel. Air vessel is required. Centrifugal pump, the thrust on the crankshaft is uniform, whereas in the reciprocating pump, the thrust on the crankshaft is not uniform. It is varying because of the reciprocating action. Centrifugal pump, priming is needed. In the reciprocating pump, priming is not needed. So in centrifugal pump, efficiency is low. In the case of reciprocating pump, the efficiency is higher. So these are all the various points of comparison between centrifugal pump and reciprocating pump. And next we discuss about the positive displacement rotary pump. So the positive displacement rotary pump resembles a centrifugal pump in its outward appearance, but differ in working. It combines the advantage of centrifugal pump, that is constant discharge, and reciprocating pump, positive displacement. So the advantage of centrifugal pump and reciprocating pump, they are combined together, and this is called as positive displacement rotary pump. There are three types of pump. The first pump is gear pump. So look at the diagram. So here we have a driver pump, driver gear, and the driven gear, and we have the suction port, suction line, and the fluid flow or delivery discharge port or the delivery line. So here we have two gears. The gears are so designed that they form a fluid tight joint at the point of contact. So here we have the point of contact. So there is no leakage of liquid through the gear contact. One of the gears is keyed to the driving shaft. Driver gear is connected to the motor. So the other revolves as a driven gear. The pump is first filled with the liquid before it starts. As the gear rotates, the liquid is trapped in between their teeth and it flows to the discharge end around the casing. So the liquid is flowing in the gap between the teeth and the casing, and it is compressed and it is delivered on the other side. The rotating gear builds up the sufficient pressure to force the liquid into the delivery pipe. So because of the liquid is trapped between the casing and the gap in the gear teeth, and the pressure is raised and the high pressure liquid is delivered on the other side of the gear. So this gear pump, normally it is used for pumping liquid, high viscous liquid. The next one is van pump. The rotor has number of slots. So look at, this is the van pump, this is the inlet line and this is the outlet pipeline, and we have the rotor here at the center. So the rotor is rotating eccentrically. So we have a shaft. The shaft is connected to the motor and it is rotating. It is eccentrically rotating. The rotor has number of slots, generally 4 to 8, containing vanes. The rotor has the vanes, which is free to slide radially into the vanes. The vanes are free to slide into the vanes. When the rotor rotates, the vanes are pressed against the casing due to the centrifugal force and form the liquid tight seal. So when the rotor is rotating, the vanes are reciprocating. Vanes are always have the contact on the casing of the machine. And as the rotor is rotating, there will be gap is varying. So look at here, the liquid is flowing in this gap and it is getting compressed as the area is changing. As the rotor rotates, liquid is trapped in the packets formed between vanes and the casing. So these are all the packets formed between vanes and the casing, and it is compressed. The vanes built up sufficient pressure to force the liquid into the delivery pipe. So the gap changing because of the rotary action of the rotor, the gap is changing. By changing the gap, the liquid is compressed and the compressed liquid is delivered on the outlet side. This is the van type of pump. And the lobe pump. So we have lobe type of pump resembles the gear pump in action. There are many design in lobe type of rotary pump. There will be three van or two van depending on the type of the amount, the pressure is required. But the wheels have usually two or three lobes. So these are all called as lobes. And these lobes are designed such that they form a fluid tight joint at the point of contact. So here they, again there is a fluid tight joint and there is no leakage of liquid through the gap. As the lobe rotates, the liquid is trapped in the packets formed between the lobe and the casing. So here you find here there will be a gap between the lobe, in the gap between the casing and the lobe, and here the liquid is trapped, and because of the rotary action of the lobe, the liquid is compressed and discharged through the delivery side. The lobe is built up sufficient pressure to force the liquid into the delivery pipe. The only drawback of the lobe is that the discharge is not constant as in the gas, as in the gear pump. So the gear pump is also here gear pump will give the continuous discharge, but here the lobe, because of the liquid is trapped here in the gap, so the delivery will be intermittent in the case of lobe type of pump. So there are three types of positive displacement rotary pump: lobe pump, van pump and the gear pump. So both are, all the three are used, normally used for handling liquid, high viscous or low viscous liquid. So we stop here. So these are all the books I have published in the mechanical engineering subject. So here you may find the fluid mechanics and machinery, and the book will be very much useful for further information on the subject and to solve problems in the fluid mechanics and machinery. And I have a YouTube channel where I upload the video lectures on the mechanical engineering subject, also the solution for the gate question paper in mechanical engineering. So you subscribe the channel and listen to the video lectures for your better learning and to pass in the gate examination. So thank you for watching. You please post your comments on the YouTube video and you subscribe the channel, use the video for your better learning, and you can write to me mail ID and or WhatsApp number for any clarification on the subject. So we'll meet again with another video lecture on the reciprocating pump. So maybe in the next lecture we will be solving problem on the reciprocating pump.